Good day, everyone. This is Dr. Soper here, and today I'll be introducing you to your Artificial Intelligence Toolkit, with a specific focus on familiarizing you with an extraordinarily useful and easy-to-use technology called Jupyter Notebooks. To begin, let's briefly review what you'll learn in this lesson. By the time you've finished this video, you will know why you need an AI toolkit, what Jupyter Notebooks are, why Jupyter Notebooks are a great way to begin developing AI and cognitive computing projects, how to create Jupyter Notebooks for free in both the Google Cloud and the Microsoft Cloud, and how to work with Jupyter Notebooks to create and run AI and cognitive computing projects. Along the way, we will actually build, train, and test an artificial neural network, and I think you'll be surprised at just how easy it is to do. To begin this lesson, let's spend a few moments talking about why you need an AI toolkit. This series of videos on cognitive computing and artificial intelligence is not just about theory and concepts. You will also learn to actually build many different types of AI models. In order to build any artificial intelligence or cognitive computing models, however, we're going to need a set of tools. First, we'll need computational resources, such as CPU, memory, and space to store our files. Second, we'll need a development environment where we can work on our AI projects. And third, we'll need a set of instructions that allow us to tell the computer what we want it to do. With respect to the last of these tools, we'll be learning the Python programming language as we work our way through these lessons, beginning with the very next video in this series. With respect to the first two items, however, we can get both computational resources and a development environment by using Jupyter Notebooks hosted in the cloud for our AI and cognitive computing projects. So what is a Jupyter Notebook? Well, a Jupyter Notebook is an interactive, web-based environment that is composed of an ordered collection of cells. Each cell in a Jupyter Notebook can contain text or programming code or mathematical formulas, or images, or many other types of media elements. This means that Jupyter Notebooks allow you to keep track of all of the notes, programming code, diagrams, visualizations, and output from your AI and cognitive computing models all in one place. Jupyter Notebooks use what are called kernels to run programming code and keep track of the current state of your project. One of the coolest features of Jupyter Notebooks is that you can run one cell at a time, and the notebook server will automatically maintain the current state of your project in its memory. This allows you to write some code in a cell, run it, and get the results. You can then write some more code in another cell, and the code in that cell will be able to access and use the results from all of the previous code cells in the notebook. Put differently, you can build and refine your project a little bit at a time, without needing to rerun everything every time you make a change. Another great thing about Jupyter Notebooks is that they support many different programming languages, including Julia, Python, and R. In fact, the notebook's support of these three languages is the origin of the term Jupyter. So why would we want to use Jupyter Notebooks instead of some other development platform? Although we certainly could use a different approach, there are many, many reasons why Jupyter Notebooks are great for AI and cognitive computing projects. First, Jupyter Notebooks run in a web browser. This means that there is no need to install or configure any specialized software, and that as long as you have an internet connection, you can work on your projects on any device, regardless of operating system, from anywhere in the world. Second, Jupyter Notebooks are completely free. Major technology companies like Google and Microsoft generously provide Jupyter Notebooks on their cloud platforms at no cost. This means that you can work on state-of-the-art AI and machine learning models without needing to pay for any expensive software. Third, Jupyter Notebooks are easy to learn and easy to use. The interface is simple and intuitive, so there is no need to spend a lot of time trying to learn how to use a complex piece of software. Finally, Jupyter Notebooks are easy to share. Since they are stored in the cloud, you can easily make your projects available to others, and you can easily clone Jupyter Notebooks that have been made by other developers. Together, all of these attributes make Jupyter Notebooks an excellent choice for developing cognitive computing and artificial intelligence projects, particularly when you first begin learning about these technologies. There are many places on the internet where you can create and use Jupyter Notebooks for free. I personally recommend using the Jupyter Notebooks provided either by Google or Microsoft, since both of these options are backed by major technology companies, and both options run in their respective parent companies' cloud platforms. The Google option is called Google Collaboratory, and can be accessed at collab.research.google.com. The Microsoft option is called Microsoft Azure Notebooks, and can be accessed at notebooks.azure.com. Each of these options has its advantages and disadvantages. For example, Google Collaboratory Notebooks provide free access to specialized hardware called GPUs and TPUs that can vastly reduce the amount of time that is needed to train complex models. Microsoft Azure Notebooks can be connected to Azure Data Science virtual machines, which can be provisioned with vast amounts of memory, storage, and computational power. Now that we know what Jupyter Notebooks are, why they're great for cognitive computing and AI projects, and where we can create Jupyter Notebooks for free, we're finally ready to see them in action. I'll be using Microsoft Azure Notebooks for this demonstration, but we could just as easily create and work with our Jupyter Notebook on another platform, such as Google Collaboratory. Before creating your first Jupyter Notebook, you'll need to sign in to whatever service you plan to use, and then create a new project. Each project can contain multiple notebooks, data files, and so on. Here I've created a project called Cognitive Computing and Artificial Intelligence. As you can see, the project does not currently contain any notebooks, so let's create one. For this demonstration, I'll create a notebook named Demo, and I'll choose Python 3.6 as my programming language. After a few moments, our new notebook appears inside the project folder. Let's open the notebook by clicking on its name. Our new notebook is now open, and we can see the Jupyter Notebooks interface. By default, our new notebook contains one cell, as shown here. This happens to be a code cell, but we can easily change it to a markdown cell by using this drop-down box. Markdown cells provide us with a place where we can write notes, add instructions, or insert mathematical formulas, images, or other media. The name Markdown refers to a lightweight markup language that allows us to easily format the appearance of the text that appears inside a markdown cell. To add text to a markdown cell, you simply need to click on the cell and start typing. You can make headings of various sizes by using the pound symbol. 1 pound symbol yields a level 1 heading, 2 pound symbols yields a level 2 heading, and so on. To see what the text looks like, simply click the Run button. Double-click on the markdown cell to return to editing mode. Continuing, you can make your text italic by surrounding it with one asterisk on each side. Or, you can make your text bold by surrounding it with 2 asterisks on each side. 3 asterisks will make your text bold and italic. If you'd like to create a bulleted list, simply type an asterisk followed by a space, and then type the text that you would like to appear next to the bullet. Additional bullet items can be created by repeating this on subsequent lines. You can create a numbered list by using the same approach, except you type the appropriate number followed by a period and a space, rather than using an asterisk and a space. There are many other types of text formatting that you can do in markdown cells. To learn more, I encourage you to search for Markdown Cheat Sheet on Google. Next, let's experiment with a code cell. As discussed a few minutes ago, code cells provide us with a place in the notebook where we can write programming code in order to tell the computer what to do. As you can see, our notebook currently contains one markdown cell and one code cell. This code cell was created automatically when we clicked the Run button in our previous markdown cell. If we'd like, we can easily add more code cells to the notebook by clicking on the Insert Cell button. Our notebook now contains three code cells, so let's write some code. As with markdown cells, to add code to a code cell, we simply need to click on the cell and start typing. To run the code cell, we simply need to click on the Run button. In this case, the line of code that I wrote tells Python to print "My name is Dan" to the screen. We can also do some quick math. In this example, I've told Python to create a variable called x and set its value to 1, to create another variable called y and set its value to 2, and to create a third variable called z and set its value to the sum of x and y. The value of z is then printed to the screen. Finally, let's save our work by clicking on File, Save, and Checkpoint. Please don't worry about writing Python code at this point. After all, this lesson is just meant to familiarize you with Jupyter Notebooks, not to teach you how to write code in Python. We'll need to wait until the next video in this series before we really start to learn about Python programming. For now, I hope you're feeling reasonably confident that you can create a Jupyter Notebook, create, edit, and format text in markdown cells, add new cells to your notebook, and switch between code cells and markdown cells. Now, as promised earlier in this video, I'll show you just how little code is needed to build, train, and test an artificial neural network to solve a real-world problem. Through the magic of video editing, I'll instantly load another notebook that contains all of the necessary code. Again, please don't feel intimidated by all of this Python code. I promise by the end of this series of videos, you will easily be able to create cognitive computing and AI projects that are far more complicated than this. For now, let's just briefly review what each section of code does from a high level. In this first code cell, we're importing all of the libraries that we'll need for the project. Libraries are simply pre-written collections of code that are designed to do different things. By importing existing libraries, we can use all of that pre-written code without having to create it ourselves. In this next code cell, we're loading our dataset for this project into a data structure called a pandas data frame. We'll learn much more about data frames throughout this video series. For this project, we'll be using the famous iris flower dataset, which was first published by Sir Ronald Fisher in 1936. The dataset consists of samples from three different species of iris flowers: Iris setosa, Iris virginica, and Iris versicolor. Four measurements were taken from each iris flower: the length and the width of the sepals, and the length and the width of the petals, in centimeters. Our goal in this project will be to train a neural network that can accurately determine the correct species of an iris flower based on these measurements. As an aside, this iris flower dataset has become very popular for teaching people about artificial intelligence and machine learning. Almost everyone encounters this dataset when they are first learning about these topics, and now you could take your place among this ever-growing group of learners. As shown in the table, each iris's species is currently recorded using textual labels: setosa, versicolor, and virginica. We will need to convert these values into a numerically coded variable before building our neural network. The next code cell in our notebook does precisely this by creating a species code column, whose values are 0 for setosa irises, 1 for versicolor irises, and 2 for virginica irises. As you can see, each species of iris has been coded with a number, 0, 1, or 2, indicating setosa, versicolor, or virginica, respectively. The next code cell randomly splits our data into a training set, which contains 70% of the data, and a testing set, which contains 30% of the data. The basic idea here is that we want our neural network to try to learn to accurately identify the correct species of iris flower by using only the data in the training set. We will then evaluate how well the neural network can correctly identify iris species by using the testing set. This approach gives us a reasonably good idea about how well the neural network will perform in the real world, because it has never before seen the data in the testing set. If the network performs well in situations that it hasn't encountered before, then it has likely done a good job of learning a general model that can usefully solve the underlying problem. The next code cell actually trains the neural network using the training data. In this example, the sepal length and width and the petal length and width are used as inputs to the neural network, and the network is attempting to accurately identify each iris flower's species. The next code cell in our notebook simply runs the testing data through our trained neural network in order to get the network's predictions about the species of each iris flower in the testing set. Remember, the neural network did not get to see any of the data in the testing set while it was being trained, so its performance in predicting the correct species of iris flower in the testing set will give us a good idea about how well the network will perform in the real world. Finally, our last code cell generates what is called a confusion matrix and prints a few additional performance statistics. Let's go ahead and run our final code cell to see how well our neural network performs. As you can see, our neural network is about 96% accurate in identifying the correct species of any iris flower. We can therefore conclude that it has learned to perform its task quite well. That's it, my friends. Excluding importing the libraries, the entire project is just 14 lines of code, and several of those lines are just printing information to the screen. Put differently, with just 14 lines of Python code, we were able to load and prepare a dataset, split the data into training and testing sets, and define, train, and evaluate the performance of a real neural network. Not bad for a few minutes' work. I hope you're starting to see that building cognitive computing and artificial intelligence models is not as scary or intimidating as many people think. You can do it. In the next video in this series, we'll begin to learn much more about writing Python code. Soon you'll be able to create artificial intelligence and cognitive computing models that are much more complex than the example we just saw. I hope you're looking forward to it. Well, my friends, thus ends our lesson on working with Jupyter Notebooks. I hope that you learned something interesting in this lesson, and until next time, have a great day.